Hey everyone, this is Trey. I just wanted to talk to you a little bit before the podcast starts. Jesse and I have already recorded everything, and we wanted to give you some timestamps so that you can tune in to whatever you feel like listening to. So today, we did a very special segment where we hired psychics to draw my soulmate. So that was really fun, and you can check that out. That's right at the beginning of the video. So all the timestamps are going to be in the description, but I just want to give you a main rundown of this episode. So today we were talking about past lives and the importance of remembering past lives. That was the main chunk of our topic. But we also got into other things like evolution, differentiating the personality from the soul, dealing with closed-minded people in a spiritual world, and discernment with psychics. And all of it came together in a really cool way, and I can't wait for you guys to listen to it. Please let us know how you liked it, and we'll see you there.
What's up, guys? Welcome to episode 12 of Jesse Trey Podcast, and today she'll just be here for a brief moment. The famous Mika, it's her second birthday, so she wanted to make a little appearance. Mika, anything to say?
Mika.
Happy birthday, Mika.
Happy birthday, Mika. Okay, back to your little things.
Maybe what a wonderful cat. I remember coming to your house and she was just a little baby.
Yeah, now she's a tigress all grown up, the Aries, Aries Scorpio. Anyways, guys, so today we have a little different format for you guys. So what have we done, Trey? What is our new segment? The new special segment we're going to have each week, right? Tell them about this a little bit.
So, okay, we were just talking the other day and we're like, okay, what can we do in the beginning of our podcast? And so we decided to introduce a special segment where every time, each podcast, we're going to have something kind of out of the ordinary that we're going to bring in, like an event or a special something that we do. And this week, I'm super excited. I hired three psychics on Etsy to draw my soulmate. So they did a psychic reading and then drew my twin flame / soulmate. And some of them gave a reading. Two of them gave a reading and one of them didn't, but I haven't looked at anything yet. So this is all fresh for everyone. So yeah,
I wasn't willing to do it because I didn't want to like mess with my current relationship by like some psychic drawing someone that's not my girlfriend potentially. So I was like, Trey, that's all you. So yeah, we got a lot for you guys today. So we're going to get started with this. So Trey, yeah, he's been holding on to these. I probably wouldn't be able to not look, but for probably a week. So yeah, we want to do this each week where we have kind of a special segment. You know, we know that people don't really like to, you know, I'm not saying you guys listening have bad attention spans, but just looking at the statistics on YouTube, you know, we know that the first 10 minutes of an episode is important. So we want to leave you guys with something of value, regardless of how long you're able to watch. So with no further ado, should we jump into that?
Let's do it. I'm really excited to take a look at this. Okay, I just need to pull up the reading.
One second, I'm gonna be right back. I need to turn on this other light because this is gonna be really bad glare.
The reading that they wrote. And all right, so I'm just going to share the screen now to there we go. We'll share that. So can you see what's going on?
I see purple and green.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, this is just the cover. So this is the Great Illusion. Okay, ready? Ready for the first one? So this first one didn't have a reading. So let's
wait. So really quickly though. So these, my understanding is these are psychics who are also artists, and you are able to find them on Etsy. Maybe we can shout out like the best one or something. And
yeah, definitely. I can even say who they are.
Yeah, just say who they are. Why not? And basically they're drawing their psychic ideas of what your twin flame or what your soulmate or who, like what you, your
yeah, your so wife, some what? Some of it was like twin flame, soulmate. I kind of just see it as the same thing, really. Yeah. All right, so this first one is from a psychic called Aphrodita. That's her name on Etsy.
Ooh.
And let's see what it is.
Oh, wow. Looks like okay. Sarita, kind
of. Right.
Our old friend from Boulder.
First impressions, not really my type, but...
This could be her at like a, you know, 35 or like old, later, maybe she would look.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm not saying she looks bad. I'm just saying that she does look like in her mid 30s, right?
Yeah, definitely. Let's try and read her. What sign do you think she would be?
I'd say like Libra or Taurus, something Venusian. What do you think?
Yeah, definitely. She looks like Libra. I mean, her eyes. I'm not connecting with her eyes that much. It feels like she doesn't go that deep. You know, I need someone who goes deep.
Yeah, I mean, maybe that's just the artist, because the eyes don't look that, I don't know.
Yeah, they don't resonate that much with me. And her smile too, it's like, eh.
She looks kind of bland.
For me, this is an It might have been a miss from this psychic. So
but maybe if we can go similar.
Yeah, we can go back and look at them all. So should we just move on to the next one and see
let's do the next one?
All right. The next one is from what's her name? Is from I think it's Psychic. Okay, her name is Psychic Drawing Design on Etsy.
Psychic Drawing Design. Ooh, similar, dude. They're super similar. Wait, can we get them both together?
The eyes are very different.
Yeah, so that's what I was saying. Go back to the first one. So the first one, I had like my feeling, like my intuition was saying like, yeah, like the face is right, but the artist wasn't really designing the eyes. So go back to the second one. Oh, shit.
See, this one I'm attracted to. This one I'm more attracted to. And blue eyes or green eyes? Yeah, definitely something around that. And I like kind of this, like how the artist had this hair cover over one of the eyes because it shows this kind of mystery, which always intrigues me. And it does feel like this person, you know, is sharp, like they go deep, you know, you can see that. Should we see what the person wrote, the psychic wrote for me?
Yeah. Well, really quickly, okay, like so, my interpretation of this, I definitely see like a very, very light spirit, lots of depth, lots of intelligence, very kind of independent, creative, understanding, and able to, kind of like Libra energy. I see Libra, Taurus, kind of grounded in herself, really able, like kind of like understanding, able to really let you do your own thing. And it's interesting, they have looked very similar so far. So goddamn, yeah, some bitch.
some bitch. All right, so this is what the psychic says. She says, this woman will have a wide face and thick lips, have big eyes, and will dance very well. That's a bonus. I like a woman who can express with her body, who can move. She's fond of love and loves sudden mood swings, and she wants her special days to remember letter name A. Wait, I don't know what that means.
Her letter name starts with an A.
Yeah. So she's very affectionate, friendly, and will cherish you very much. This woman is very friendly with a slight harsh personality. So I think you can see that in her eyes. There's this like, she goes deep. It's kind of, there's like a Scorpio.
Yeah. At the same time. I was thinking a Libra, like.
I just read the rest of it. So
she might be like a Libra Scorpio, like a Scorpio moon with like a Libra sun.
Yeah.
And maybe double Scorpio.
I just read that the psychic did her zodiac too. So we can.
Yeah, what is it? Scorpio, Libra?
Wait, I'll get to it. So this woman is very friendly. Oh yeah, okay. You will meet this woman in the summer and she's so hot. That's what the psychic writes.
Drunk.
The sacral chakra is very strong. Your love season begins with the summer. Hazel eyes. So hazel is like brown with like green in the middle. Auburn hair. And the zodiac moon is Leo with Sun Scorpio. And she's a 23-year-old. She said, super sexy,
sun,
very
sun
hot
what?
Lady.
Sun Scorpio?
Yeah, Sun Scorpio, Moon Leo.
Interesting.
Oh, what the hell? It says Greek nationality. Greek.
Yo, I just thought of Greek. When it said summer, I just thought of how much you always talk
Holy
about
shit.
How hot the Greek girls were in summer when you were there.
Yeah.
Dude, you're gonna be with a Greek. You're gonna be next door to me, bro.
That's awesome. Greek person. And we have what are we? I think our most viewed country is in Greece, right?
Yeah, maybe this girl's already stalking you. So they said Leo Moon, Scorpio Sun. What a great combo.
Yeah.
That's like actually the exact same as my cat Fedix, who was just here as this reading was being done. He was on the table and he's actually a Scorpio Sun, Leo Moon. So that's another, that's something, dude. That's kind of crazy.
Yeah, very interesting.
Yeah, he was sitting right next to it. So, okay. It's pretty hot.
Okay, and we have one more. So this person also said she's very sexual. Especially
nice.
At night. She said, cool. I'm going to meet her at nighttime.
So. Oh, it's because you're going to be up in your Mars and you're going to be like a sex addict. By the way, speaking of that, we should have Katarina on our next podcast. She already said yes, but
okay,
remind
cool.
me.
All right. Last and final one. So this is from the psychic. What's her name? Oh, it was like, yeah, Cleo psychic. So like Cleopatra psychic.
And how much did you spend like, money-wise on all three of these? Like 40 bucks?
Each
bucks?
One was around 15 to 18 US dollars. So I think that's pretty good deal for something of this.
This one is really good. Tell me the name of the second one again. Yeah. I really fuck with the second one.
The second one was psychic drawing design.
Psychic drawing design on Etsy. So...
Yeah.
Yeah, around $18 for something this detailed. That's pretty cool. They should be paying us for this advertisement. Just joking. We don't get
All right, and
for that.
The third and final one. Okay, let's go and check it out. Okay.
I don't see. This is the one where this is the one that took the longest.
No, the other that one canceled. This there was a one from Russia, and she.
Yeah.
Canceled just completely without saying anything. So I don't know what that was about.
This
and
looks like a different
one,
person.
Yeah, this one looks like she took a photo and then put it through a pencil app. You
this
know,
one's
you
shit,
know how
dude.
You can yeah, you know you can have that drawing where you can put a photo and it turns it into a drawing. That's what this looks like.
What's that app called? It sounds cool.
You can do that on in light. I know that. All right, well, let's just see the reading and see what she says.
This one seems
okay.
off to me, and we'll see.
Yeah. Okay, let's see. So you and your soulmate shared many lives together. I see spontaneous journeys in your future. You both have good karma to receive traveling. Okay, that sounds good.
Lucky.
You're an extremely well-endowed person with deep observation, understanding skills, and spiritual
Wait, she just said
attraction.
You had a big dick?
Is that
she said well-endowed. That means big
dick.
Is
that dick. What that means?
I mean, yes, dude. If you say, like, he's well-endowed, that means, like, I mean, there's other meanings to it. Like, you can be well-endowed, like, spiritually or well-endowed. Usually...
I don't think she means it by the big dick way.
I know.
She follows
funny.
It by deep observation.
Well endowed.
Okay, well, this is all true so far. She's given me a little reading.
Yeah.
One of your strengths is your superior discernment compared to other people. You are well organized and orderly, and you need someone just like you to have a relationship that will work as well as possible. Your soulmate doesn't
Facts.
Seem as serious to you as she might to others. Both of you are straight shooters, but there are some differences between you. You may be more interested in providing clear and practical services than her, and they're more interested in success, which is their key word. Okay. Although both of you are economical, you are much more optimistic. She is the ruler of Saturn, but you know how to control her. Okay.
Control her.
I don't know. She will feel refreshed and young. I don't know what the fuck that means. She will respond better to you.
That means that she'll feel refreshed and young. So this is making, dude, this reading is kind of off to me because it's making her sound like very, or maybe, you know, another idea it has, like, yeah. what if there's two, like, what if this is just speaking about two different girlfriends you have? I mean, it's not like you're only going to have one. So maybe this is a different girl you date. Like maybe the first two is one that's Scorpio, Leo energy. You know, I saw Libra, maybe I was just seeing the rising. And this one maybe is a more like Capricorn, Virgo, Taurus, kind of more like Saturn energy, more of a serious person that.
Well, this person has thick lips too. If we zoom in on the lips, she's got thick lips too.
Or maybe this is her at 45. Maybe this is just her at a different age and we're just getting fucked by that.
She said, the psychic says this will be a business oriented relationship where you'll most probably meet each other. But if you delve more deeply, you'll see that she has a strong influence on you.
Dude, my intuition is saying that this one, like, if you were this is either someone you meet before the main one, which is the first one, or after, like maybe if there's like if you don't stay with the first one for forever, like this would maybe be someone you meet later in life where it's something like that, or someone before that. Why is this fucking person? One second. Or you keep talking. 1 second.
Yeah. So. Let's see, if I go through them all, let's zoom out, go up. Okay. So this one, I'm just not down with the face, although it matches the description from the second one, which is kind of a wider with thick lips. So it does have this match, but there's something about the way that this person is looking at me that I am not into.
This first one?
Yeah, just, I'm like, don't look at me like that. Why are you looking at me like that?
You know, like she's gonna lick you like food.
Yeah. She looks like someone you would find at like the paralegal's office.
That's yeah, like, yeah.
You know, just like in a suit, in like a woman's suit, and just like a very nice person. But I don't know. Psychic number one, not for me.
I like what psychic number one did. I just don't think she's as good of an artist. I think she saw the truth, but I think artist number, I think the first two complement each other. And if you go from one to two, I don't know if you can share them on the same stream. I don't think so, but they actually are similar. See, this is like it's similar, dude. That's yeah.
This one seems so much deeper than this one, you know?
But it's because she fucked up the
lips,
eyes,
and dude. Her lips are like, look at those lips. They kind of, they're like, they're really like.
Okay, so the second one is the one you want it to be.
The second one is this one. I mean, she's
way more attractive than the other two. And you know, I'm guessing is
your view. But it's also the stare, right?
Yeah,
the stare,
yeah.
And like the Scorpio Leo that sounds like, and Greek nationality, like.
Yeah, that's like, some crazy shit. And you've always, Trey's always gone to Greece. Every, like, his family's gone to Greece most summers since he's been young and still currently. Yeah. So it makes sense. Let's stick with number two. Whatever.
Yeah, my grandmother and my grandfather bought a house in Greece. Like, she wanted to have her ashes spread, like my grandmother, in Greece in the ocean. So.
That's not the only thing that's going to be. That's not the only thing that's going to be spread in Greece.
What, hummus?
Yeah, I was talking about hummus. But yeah, you have the connection to the land.
Tzatziki.
Tzatziki or tzatziki? Tzatziki.
Tzatziki. Yeah, and this girl, she just seems. She seems
like a really good, like a really good friend.
Yeah, she seems like a cool friend. And maybe it will kind of be like a friendship relationship. Cause for me, I see soulmates like not as.
I just got it, dude. this middle one is like that fucking flame. I'm not sure how long it lasts, but like, this is the one you're the most in love with, where it's just like crazy. But then sometimes shit gets in love, gets so wild, you know, and maybe like it's the one that's the twin flame or whatever, where it impacts you the most. The next one, right? The third I see is like a friend, like someone who's just consistent, because Saturn is consistent over time, who's there for, you know, who just like serves an incredibly huge purpose, but it might not be romantic. The first one, I think, was just a failed attempt at the second one. That's what I think. Right.
Yeah, because this first one, her, like, in terms of her features, it matches the second person's description, but there's just something off. Like, maybe the psychic didn't get a deep enough reading or something like that. It just...
And let's just say it, dude. Some psychics are bullshit. So we don't really know what we're getting into here. A lot of people, they want to see, you know, they want to get a picture of their soulmate. You draw them a picture of someone that's attractive or someone that they think that you like. You know, we understand, we're not naive over here. Like, there are scammers that exist. There are people who, you know, like, maybe they're just off. So
yeah. And it's Etsy, right? So you're getting anyone. It's not like a service where they've screened their psychics, you know, kind of tested them. This is just like any person can make a gig on here. So I tried to choose the ones that were the best rated, but you have to take everything with a grain of salt, because, you know, obviously it could just be people behind a computer just drawing random people. So,
and the third one could be that, you know, the third one could just be some random shit, and nothing wrong with her. You know, she's, you know,
I like the third one more than I like the first one. I think this is a cool person that I would get along with.
Similar interests and shit. Maybe she's super smart and super spiritual. You guys like do like some kind of like alchemy or witchcraft, or like build something together. Like, cause she seems like a Capricorn, this one.
Yeah. And if the psychic said, if we're going to be meeting in terms of like business goals, you know, I'm never really the one to use the word business, but I do have dreams and aspirations that, you know, will take form in what you could call a business, but I would not ever call it that. I just call it like doing what I love, you know?
Yeah. But one day you'll call
it could be in a, it could be in a way where we do meet somewhere along those lines, but we'll see. You know, it would be really interesting to make a podcast, you know, in a year or so and see like,
see what's good with all that.
See if I've met any of these psychic drawed people.
Yeah. But didn't Gigi, our friend, like a while ago, say you're going to like meet your like twin flame that summer and she'd be a blonde skateboarder, and that never happened?
Yep.
Yeah. So people are wrong a lot, especially when it comes to love. But all you can do is just take it as entertainment. And if it happens.
Although, wait, I did have a sexual relationship with a blonde girl who skateboarded.
The Mexican?
No. It was, I had a summer relationship with Kenna. In Boulder, and she skateboards and is blonde.
Yeah.
Huh. Interesting.
So.
No, Gigi.
Because Gigi did that. She might have been like, she did that right before you left, right? And you left in the winter of Colorado, right? Or did you leave in the spring in 2019?
No,
you left earlier.
In February.
In February of 2019?
Or March or some shit, yeah. I left February 2019. I moved to Romania start of April 2019.
Holy shit, actually, Gigi was right. It happened.
Oh, goddamn, Gigi. Gigi. Okay, well, cool. Well, I think we're probably good for our special segment of the day at first ever, right? Any other comments?
No, yeah. So here it is, three psychic drawings. Let me know which one you think best suits me from your opinion.
Yeah, let us know what you guys think about these.
Scorpio, baby. Scorpio.
Yeah, Leo, Scorpio. She's definitely the one you'd like the most. Cool. Well, awesome. So now we will segment into our main podcast.
Hey everyone, Trey here again. Really hope you enjoyed that special segment. Jesse and I had a super fun time looking over those drawings, and this is just a quick reminder. If you like what we do and want to support us, then give us a like or comment and subscribe, and we would be so, so grateful. Thank you. And on to the rest of the podcast.
So I hope you guys enjoyed that special segment, and we're doing things a little bit different now. So yeah, that was interesting, man. That was interesting.
Yeah.
Always got to take those things with a grain of salt, though, you know?
Yeah, because, you know, psychics, there's psychics out there who really get out of the way and who really actually see what's, you know, what's at the root of everything. There's some really good psychics out there. But there's also psychics who have a lot of who are still practicing, and so their own projections or their own thoughts will kind of get in.
Yeah.
And also psychics are perceiving one timeline, you know, they're perceiving a specific array of events. You know, they might be seeing real things, but you know, any little deviation from that and everything could change. Even the fact of getting the reading could change the outcome of what the futures are actually going to hold. So
facts. Yeah, man, definitely. So anyways, dude, I just had an idea of something I kind of want to talk about. I think it's very, very relevant to a lot of people that are in spirituality, right? And maybe you can give some insight on this as I tried to develop this idea that just came to me. So I don't know if you're really bothered by this, but you know, obviously us spiritual people, we are a minority in this world, and we all have family members or people around us, even friends who, you know, might think astrology is bullshit, might think, you know, like might be atheists, might think, you know, everything we're doing is like kind of like clownish and immature, just disvaluing it all. Right. And I think it'd be nice for us to kind of speak a little bit about how that's been for us and how we have dealt with that and how we continue to deal with that when it comes up. For me, you know, I can definitely say that around like half of my family, like my mom is very spiritual. So there's no limits around that. But I often feel like around a lot of my family members, I feel like I'm almost walking on eggshells a lot of the time. Which sucks, because like, I just feel like spirituality and like the way I see the world, astrology, the esoteric symbolism, it's so huge. And like, I always want to like wonder, like, for example, like my brother just, you know, met a new girl, and I would love to like ask him about her astrology and compare the charts, but like, I can't go into that. So I kind of just have to like, you know, just sit myself back and just say, nice, I hope it goes well. And I've realized throughout my life that it's almost like it's an ongoing practice, and it's one of those things sort of like meditating or sort of like mental health in general, where if you kind of let yourself slip, you can start to kind of let people get to your head in that type of way. Not that anyone like messages me directly, but for example, if I'm just watching a YouTube video and astrology comes up and some guy like makes a comment about like astrology being bullshit, like, I don't know, these types of things, you know what I mean, kind of, Trey?
Yeah, definitely. And what you were kind of originally talking about, like how to, you know, deal, or because I remember when I first started spirituality, it was like, you know, I gotta spread the word, I gotta spread the gospel. It's like I became a preacher, yeah. Right, of like all these things, because they were so close to my heart, and I just wanted to share it with people. And I quickly learned that most people do not want to hear what you're fucking saying, and most people will try to discredit you, will try to disprove you through like logic or rationale, and will try to devalue your experiences, very real experiences that you're having, because, you know, it doesn't fit into their world. So what I kind of realize is like, you know, you have a sensor of how it's your, you know, your beliefs and everything are going to be received. And so I stopped sharing as much. Ooh, and yes. I realized, you know, I felt kind of like Christ, like a Christian person who stands on the side of the street who just shouts out, like, you know, who's trying to get everyone to join the church. It's like, you don't want to listen to that when you just walk down the street.
Exactly.
So what I learned is, you know, I can have these discussions with people who are like-minded, but then when it comes to other people, you really can't go into that sphere unless they're open-minded and they're asking questions and you kind of get into a dialogue like that, where it's like an open exchange of ideas, where it's not you trying to prove something and them trying to disprove you, because then that just gets nowhere.
Because that's just a battle, right? Like, it's just an ego battle and no one's actually listening. I really like what you said. It made me think of, like, for me, how my new approach in recent years, like, I was totally like you before. And I remember, like, actually, like, convincing atheists. Like, I met this guy once in Romania when I was first visiting, and I literally convinced this dude who was complete atheist. And after a few hours, I had, like, just, but I it took me so much energy. And now he's like a spiritual guy. But like, I opened it, and I know I did a great thing for this guy, but like, he's a rare one, you know, like a lot of the people, like when I was in that early stage of that, especially that my Sagittarius moon, it really wants to kind of like what you were saying, I've learned all this amazing stuff. It's out of love. I just want you to learn it. But I think people take that more as ego than purely like, yo, I would just teach this stuff, like no cameras on, like just me and you. I don't care about anything. I just like want people to experience like this light and this higher, I guess, like new way of looking at life and new perspectives and new opportunity, new optimism. But yeah, I realized in time that it just took too much effort. And, you know, sometimes it was just painful. I'm not going to say it was like traumatic or like made me like was like sad, like really bad. It's just annoying. So now I'm very much like, you can come, you know, like I'll plant seeds, and if you're interested, you'll come to me. You know, I have my things I say, like, you know, obviously I'm an astrologer. You know, if people like ask me about it that don't know anything, I'll just be like, yeah, it's, you know, it's complicated. It's a lot more than the mainstream makes it out to be. It's quite complex. And I leave it at that, you know?
Yeah. Well, like I was hanging out with my high school friend Vishnu the other day. And, we're from high school. So at one point we were very synced, and then, you know, we all took our separate paths, and, you know, I had this crazy transformation away when I was at university, and, you know, we come together, and when we talk, it's like, you know, we kind of get up to idea, you know, we kind of talk how we've been, and it's like, so he's like, how you been? And like in my head, it's like, I just, you know, I traveled to another dimension. I'm researching past lives. I'm using breath work to energize my cells and alkalize my body. And I'm drawing an energy from the ether. But then my response was,
that's like, yeah, a funny meme. You should make a meme of that. Like, how are you, man? How have you been? Old high school friends meeting. And then it has like a bubble that says everything you said. And like, fine. That's actually a genius meme.
Exactly. But the thing is, what I kind of realize is like spirituality, when I first was into it, I often took it into the realm of ideas. So it's like, I almost needed it validated by another person for it to be real for me. And as I kind of transitioned out of that, I was like, spirituality is not about words. It's not about how people believing you or people, you know, having the same beliefs as you. It's about how you are, how you exist, and how people will see that. If you're connected spiritually and you have this aura of strength and you're full of energy, people see that. And it's like, I've had people like where it's like, yo, like, what are you doing? Like, you know, you seem so chill, you seem like really open, you seem, and it's like they come and they're just like, so what is it? And there's this magnetism that you start to generate when you do spiritual practices. And then it's like, when people ask, then it's like, oh yeah, I give them like a little thing, like, oh yeah, I do breath work or I do yoga. And yeah. Most people just stop it there, you know? But it's the people who continue to ask questions. Those are the people I know that are actually really interested. And those are the people I give my energy to. Because when I give my energy to those people, there's a reciprocity. Because I'm being listened to and they're returning that energy that I'm giving, because it's listening is a back and forth thing.
Yeah. And like, I feel like we all have like a certain like amount of energy we're able to give in that kind of way, like how I described, of just like telling this guy everything about astrology, reading, you know, like we all have a certain amount until we kind of burn out and just realize like, fuck it, it's not worth it. Like, it's just too much. But like, at the same time, I feel like lately I've been getting too closed down to like where there are actually maybe like someone, and I haven't really been socializing in the past year very much, but like, it just hasn't, I don't know. I also want to like remind myself to still be open to when those times come, you know?
Yeah, because it's true. It can be very disheartening sometimes, especially
vulnerable,
when you don't have,
dude.
Yeah, it is a vulnerable thing to share, especially when you don't have like-minded people around you, which is why the Cosmos community was actually a very healing thing, because to be, because like when I moved to London, I had no one around me that was spiritual. And so it was just me. And constantly being met with like energy of like, kind of, you know, I would talk, I tried to just like express ideas, but it would just get lost, you know, in the spheres. And I was like, God, it made me feel like isolated from spirituality. And I did close down, just like you said, a bit. But then with kind of Cosmos community and having these like-minded people to generate these ideas and generate this energy, it kind of opened things back up again. And it's very easy to close down when everyone around you is closing down the second you're trying to share your points of views and your ideas.
Yeah. And by the way, people who don't know, new followers or people who don't know what Cosmos Community is, Cosmos Community is something I started at the end of last year. You can join through my Patreon. It's only $10. What's the lowest tier is only $10 a month. You have to like message me if you're interested, because now I'm going to start to like, we've had some one bad experience with someone joining who was pretty much a psychopath. So I'm going to start actually like doing a little bit of screening with people. So just message me, but you feel free to join, message me, and then we get you in like the group chat. And it's an amazing thing. We have two Zoom meetings every month. So it's every other Sunday at around, I think, 4 Eastern USA time. So for me, it ends up being 3 Eastern time now, because we changed the hour. And it's been amazing. We're talking about not just astrology. It doesn't matter if you don't know everything about astrology. We're talking about tons of different topics, and it's kind of like a little family. So let me know if you're interested in joining that. But yeah, also with Trey, Cosmos, how I say this, there's been some interesting energy. I feel like it's shown me a lot about human psychology, just some of the recent occurrences. I'm not just talking about you know who, but just with some of like, I wrote Cosmos snakes down on my paper. And you know, nearly everyone in there right now is amazing, but there's been some events, you know, that have led to other events that kind of made me think a lot about something deeper, about how easy it is to let someone in, not even like something like Cosmos, but maybe even like as a friend, you know, how people can appear so one way, and how like this is just keeps coming up for me, dude. It's like I need to be way more discerning about who I let in my life. And always just kind of try to keep my circle smaller, because like, I don't know, you just see people like present like this, I don't want to say any names, but this, and it's not who you think it is, but just like even this one individual who seemed so positive at the start, only to like have this individual go behind my back and like a hateful, 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 psychopathic, Instagram post written about me. I was like, wow, that's crazy. So that's why we're doing the screening. But yeah, it's just interesting.
I think, you know, I've been going to kind of workshops and gatherings and spiritual kind of community things for a while. You know, if it's like a, you know, psychic development class or, you know, any of those things. And there always seems to be that one or two people within these classes that are, I want to say vampiric.
Yeah.
Because they just take up space and energy and time in a really kind of negative way.
Selfish and negative, yeah.
What happens is, you know, we'll be talking about, let's say we'll be talking about astrology, okay? And all of a sudden they're going into topics about how their husband murdered some schoolgirl, or, you know, murdered yeah. some.
It's all about them. They're not here to share the energy and to grow and to learn. They're here to, like, in some way validate themselves and have us validate them. And then it just kind of messes things up, right?
Yeah, it's like they're trying to gather attention and energy from the people in the group. And it's like, we're here to learn something. You're not learning anything, right? Like, we're here to learn about this. But what everything you say, everything that comes out of your mouth has nothing to do with this. You know, so where is your mind? You're so self-focused that it disrupts the whole thing. And there's always this like moment of pause after the person speaks. And then the facilitator or whatever will be like, so anyway, like, you know, it's like you transition on to like the next thing. It's just,
Yeah, that's some interesting stuff, but I'm happy, you know, like my energy and like how I've dealt with it is I've been very, very honest and upfront. I've given people second chances. There's only been two issues. One of them was more personal to me, which I won't talk about at all because I feel like honoring that one. And the other one, I will never say names, but I handle things very, 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 very assertively and honestly. I tell people, look, like, this is what's going on. I'll give you a second chance. And second chance happened. And I was very respectful. Like, look, like, this is the deal. Like, I'm trying to have like an environment that works. And, you know, I've given you a second chance. And once again, you've gone against it. So that's all that happened. But let's not spend too much time on that. I kind of just wanted to throw that in there because I know that, like, you know, this can segue us to our next topic, which is, like we were talking about earlier, how a lot of people like this also exist within healing circles, right, Trey?
Yeah. It's, you know, there's so many psychics out there, and there's some psychics, you know, believe it or not, they might actually have some abilities, but they don't have... There's something off about their energy, or, you know, they're not in a place where they can give you a good reading, and they might send you down a negative timeline, or they might perceive your readings, or they might give you a very negative reading so that you can come to them more for healing. So there's a lot of fakes, especially in this time. It's so important to be discerning, just like Jesse was talking about earlier, discernment in this world, because there's so many that are going to take advantage, and some people who don't even want to take advantage but are just should not be psychics or should not be healers, because they first have to work on themselves. And I've come up with a lot of people like this who, you know, claim to be, you know, connected to higher beings, but then everything that they are just makes me feel off. It makes me feel weird and bad.
So what are your tips? Like the first one that would come to my mind would be like, feel how it feels in your body when you're reacting to them. Like, what does your intuition say? You know, what else would you say, Trey?
Yeah. So it's like, if you're going to be choosing a psychic, if you're going to go down that road, I would really have a call with them first to kind of like, or assess them, like really take the time to sit and, you know, you have a compass in your body. If things don't feel right, you know, if things feel like you can't kind of feel distant, or maybe you feel anxious, you should really check that. What you really want is someone who's very open and wants the best for you. And you have to find that and discern that within your body, just like Jesse said. It's a feeling. Yeah. You feel good. You want to be around this person. You feel like they're spreading a good message. You know, you don't feel like they're fake. There's no fakeness. There's an authenticity there. So
yeah, because like, you know, I wrote it like the buzzword, like a lot, like some psychics might actually just be psychos. And I'm not saying that to like, you know, that's just kind of a play on words, but like even astrologers, like, and this is completely different. And this is something I've seen with my own eyes. I've seen people who I knew for a fact, knew nothing about astrology. And I could tell, start to like offer readings. And this is not to anyone that like is in my immediate circle, anyone like recent. This is something that I saw a lot maybe like a year ago. And I was alarmed, you know, at this person who maybe was my like client. I remember one client I had, I'm not in contact with her at all, but you know, she was my client and she literally knew nothing. And then like a month later, she was doing readings. And like, I was just like, man, like, I mean, it's not as dangerous as like a psychic reading, but I just knew that she didn't know astrology. Like there's no way you can learn it in a month, you know? Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I met this guy at a bar who said he wanted to sign up for this psychic app. It's like where you get readers, and he knew nothing about spirituality. Like I've been talking to him and he was just like, yeah, I want to sign up because it's easy money. And yeah,
exactly, dude. Yeah. Like you could just be a fake. Like, and this is like my dad, kind of a dick sometimes, good guy, but like when I was first doing astrology, like he pissed me off. It's in my book. He like said like, oh, are you still like taking, like stealing money from these, like stealing like $100 from these people? And I just exploded. Like I was kind of drunk and I just went, I just fucking, that Scorpio energy in me just I just said something so hurtful. And then right after I was like, oh, his girlfriend and my brother were there. And it was just like that thing that's just so fucked up, you could say, you know? And yeah. Anyways, what was my point with that is that, yeah, like I thought about the actor. I was like, maybe his experience, like maybe he, you know, he's heard of like some fucking asshole who just like said like he was a, like they were a psychic and just literally just said bullshit. Because you can do that. You can make money. Imagine if I just fucking like, I'm a psychic, right? I'm a psychic. I create an Instagram page, psychic readings, $50 or $100. People call me and I just fucking talk bullshit. I just look at them. I see them. I could honestly, and I am like intuitive. I'm not psychic, but like I could probably do that, but it would be bullshit. It would be bullshit because I admit that like, although I have a very strong intuition, I'm not a psychic, you know, and I couldn't offer that. And I feel like people can do that in a very bullshit way.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many fakes out there. But, you know, with your dad, it could also have been like a past life thing where maybe he had some bad experience with kind of that energy in a past life. So he's very distrusting of it now. And
yeah, totally true. It's in his chart, actually, what you said that. I think I forget what indicator exactly. Yeah, I think the Saturn in Pisces, lots of things. But yeah, it's interesting how astrology correlates with everything because my dad's Saturn is exactly my Pisces sun. And Saturn is like where you have restriction. And my Pisces sun is that spiritual part of me. So it's just like that karma is exactly aligned. Is that crazy? and his Black Moon Lilith is at the same place, dude. So Black Moon Lilith is like your darkness. It's like it's kind of an indicator of like where there's darkness, where there's pain. And there's a lot more of an explanation to it. But in one instance, it's like there's like a potential like dark energy, like associated with higher spirituality, because that's what I represent, high Pisces energy, Pisces 28 right. degrees. So yeah, interesting stuff, man.
So yeah, that's very interesting as well. Just like considering, you know, if we're talking about why you were paired with this person and then your chart has these really harsh aspects in some regard.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
It's like, okay, so what does that mean? Like you have a father figure in this lifetime that's gonna mm-hmm. bring out this very specific energy towards you.
Dude, that's a great idea to talk about that. Yeah, so family charts and astrology is so fucking interesting because, and I'll give you guys just a quick example from my family. My dad and me, we're cool now, you know, we're good. We talk, we're just on the phone the other day, like watching football together, soccer. But growing up, it was tough. And my brother was always favored by my dad, my younger brother. And it wasn't until I looked at the astrology that I realized that my dad's, as I just said, my son, 28 Pisces, right? So you look at, mm-hmm. when you do two people's charts together, you look at how they align, if there's any like common points. So my 28 degree Pisces son, my identity, who I am, is exactly on his Saturn, which is a very restrictive and dark and stale planet of restriction and just karmic difficulty.
And rules and...
Yeah, rules, like harsh father, like authority yeah, yeah. figure. And then Black Moon Lilith, which is darkness. So it's literally showing. And then my brother's
childhood trauma, right?
So like I brought all that up from past life trauma. Yeah, Chiron's like wounded child kind of stuff. But my point is that my brother, his son at whatever cancer, I think like 14 cancer maybe, is exactly on my dad's Jupiter. And they're both cancers. So my dad's Jupiter, Jupiter's all about enhancement and like optimism, positivity, learning, just like it's like very like open energy. While my dad naturally was very restrictive energy, even though we have lots of like love and past lives working together in higher places. It's like, you know, it's like shamans and Native Americans and stuff like that. It's just crazy to think about.
Yeah, that's a really like cool dynamic to have written, especially so you have this, you observe this dichotomy between how your father treats you, between how your father treats your brother, and then you see it reflected in the chart.
Yeah. Have you looked at anything with your family or seen that?
No, I haven't. No.
Well, your dad's a Pisces. I don't think you have much in Pisces, do you? If anything, but I think his son might be opposing your son potentially. So that's interesting.
Yeah. We'd take a look at that later. But, you know, we were also talking about like past lives and.
Yeah. You want to segue there?
Yeah. I was thinking about, you said you had past lives with your parents. I know that some psychics revealed some past life for you and your.
Yeah, dude, we've all had past lives with our parents. I mean, come on. I've had a lot. You're asking about what my past lives I know about with like my current parents from dreams and
I think it'd be cool, interesting, the like just to jump into it, like just some experiences
and just kind of to explain to the people like how many things are possible. So I've been married to my mom, which isn't, I know that sounds weird, but like it's just like it's not weird. It's more of like a dynamic of love and just like energies, and you know, we were in different bodies at that time, so that I know it's obvious, like, you know, there is a really deep love connection there. And my brother has been my son before, so I've been told a story about how like I left for war. It was really sad, and he, you know, I died in war, and basically he had no father. And my current father and me have had a lot of past lives together. A lot of the times it's like probably friends, either friends, brother, or father, son. I think we've traded father, son a lot of times, my dad and me. Like I've been my dad's father a lot, which makes total sense. And there's, it's just an interesting dynamic, especially the one the shaman told me about.
Yeah, that exchange is very interesting, because like if we see how he's kind of playing with you, the relationship dynamic now, like, because if we're seeing the soul as an, you know, entity that exists outside of time, that transits between, you know, play to play, from life to life. Yeah. You see kind of everything else, all the material world, as this enactment of scenes from like a movie or from a play. And what are we learning from these scenes? And you know, your father kind of has this, you know, where he really triggers you is when he's hitting kind of your passion. It's like with a negative flare, right? So it's like,
yeah,
what you talked about it before, it's like your passion is astrology. It's something really close to your heart, something you really care deeply about. And then he's hitting it with this like criticism. And it's like, so what does that do? What does that generate for you? Like, how, like, it's kind of turned this into a therapy session.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's all good. He's totally cool now. Yeah. He hasn't said something. Yeah, yeah. I think since then he's been totally chill. He just asked me, like, I think he'll get around to it. He's just stubborn, Taurus moon. Mm. But yeah, man, I think past lives, like, it made me think, like, how we look at reincarnation. Because, like, one way I look at it is I think, like, every human I meet in some substance, I wonder about the karma, because I know I've been alive thousands of times. I don't know if it's thousands or hundreds of thousands or hundreds or whatever. And I'm always curious. And that's when I look at the astrology. Like, my girlfriend, she has like a new friend, for example, this is a random example. And I just looked at her chart, and her friend's south node is exactly my fucking sun. Just like random, like a person I've never met. And like right away, I know, like, that I've had some past lives with this person that I've never even met before. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, like, past lives. So, you know, some may ask, like, even in the spiritual community, some may ask, what is the point of understanding your past life, right? Especially in the spiritual community, we have so much wrapped up around the present moment, you know, and, you know, looking to the past and everything like that, stay in the present moment, smell the trees, you know. Okay, but this is where past life regression, so remembering your past lives, is actually a very kind of crucial point of development within your understanding of your grander self, your bigger sense of self. Because so past life regression is when you can find these on YouTube. There's a really good one actually that I know, where you just do a meditation, and someone, it's like a hypnotic meditation where someone takes you into a regression of your past life. And Jesse, you read and you introduced me to this book, Many Lives, Many Masters. So you are more of an expert in terms of like the clinical trials, kind of the psychology behind that. So
I've read tons of books about it. Yeah. Like Dr. Newton, forget the name, like Many Lives, Many Masters was the book that, like, you'll see if you guys read
Weir, right? Stephen Weir or something, or
I forget. So I have it over there sitting somewhere. But Dr. Newton, I forget the name. You can just search the past lives Newton, like Isaac Newton, but Newton, and he has a lot of books. They're incredible. And it's based
Brian
on
his past Weiss. Life.
Yeah, Brian Weiss.
Many lives, but many masters.
Newton is more of like a case study. Like, he, like, just like, yeah, it's amazing stuff. But you're saying, so the point of remembering your past lives.
Yeah. So firstly, like, some of the things that it can do is, like, even in therapy, so this is what I see in therapy. In therapy, you have to go back into your past, right? And you have to find and dig up that trauma, right? Because a lot of us have pushed it away, or we don't remember it properly. You have to go and find that trauma, and you have to come to terms with it. You have to have a resolution. And that you know, sometimes there's so much in our past just for this life that we can't even think about going into another life, right?
Yeah.
But when you, sometimes there's energy in your body and you cannot trace it to anywhere. You cannot, if you've done big therapeutic work, you cannot trace it to any past trauma or past moment that's happened in this life. And what happens is, the point of this is, like, to discover really your grander self and to actually be in the present, which is actually a wrapping of the past and future. When people get older, when people get older, they start talking to past versions, like to people that are long dead, or they'll start thinking about what to do tomorrow. Their past, present, and future kind of collapses into a single moment, which is what happens with children. Whereas, adults and just regular people, we're perceiving it linear. But at the beginning of time and at the end of our life, things start to they start to not become linear anymore. And the point of this is I had this past life regression, okay? And there was one in Egypt, and I have had another one recently that I might go into, but I was taking a shower and I felt that version of myself right behind me. And I felt a connection to so many more past lives before me. And what that did was it anchored my soul into that and to who I really was, shaped over all those lives. Like I've been walking through millions of mirrors, like through life after life after life. And it gave me this huge, grand, like church of who I am and what self is.
That's awesome. So you're able to see through all these past lives, like what in your current life is ego bullshit, like not lasting, and what parts of you are lasting. That sounds invaluable.
Exactly. Yeah. And it really was like, whoa, connecting to your past lives is like connecting to yourself. It's part of this whole journey. It's like connecting to those past lives brings back memories and feelings and a connection to history and to the future and to other worlds. And it just expands the sense of self out of this, just like all the, the little thoughts that you get stuck into your head, and that you think that this life is so important, that you are so important. It really just like brings it all out. And it's like, wow, like all these, it even helps to like lighten the load that's going on here, because it's like your past selves have got your back. Like we've been through this, we've been through these trials. Like,
yes, dude, exactly. And that's like how I think of things when I'm going through like really tough times. I think I've said this before, I'm not sure on here. I always visualize myself in a past life, in a different body with the same soul, same heart, going through that challenge. And I imagine myself failing at it. And I imagine and then I bring myself back to the present, and I allow that to serve as motivation to get past whatever is difficult.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a really beautiful, like it's a really strong visualization. It can help you to even see like, okay, because when, when we're in our own shit, it's hard to reflect, right? But if we see someone else going through the same shit as us, we're so readily, easily available to give advice, right? We can give advice to this person. Then when it comes to ourselves, but so if we kind of shift that, visualize, ourselves in a different body, we can maybe see that clearer.
Yeah, man. It's really interesting stuff. It's completely changed the way I look at everything. And it definitely takes a load off where suddenly you're like, people, you can just kind of chill out. You've had so many lifetimes. You don't have to do everything in this one lifetime. You can just chill, let things come to you, be more passive, be more, not complacent where you're just being lazy, but it's given me inner peace. It's given me a sense of flow, a sense of understanding of how the divine works, or, kind of meta understanding, I guess. And just, it's really helped with a lot of my mental health and a lot of the issues that were plaguing me in the past. It's probably the most important thing I ever learned about were past lives.
Yeah. It really opens a doorway. Like something that was closed through, upbringing, conditioning, it's closed off. And when it gets closed off, it really limits our existence. And I find the more that I tap into and connect with...
Second, I'm going to be right back. I'm listening to you.
Okay.
Keep talking.
Yeah, the more I tap in and connect with my past lives, I feel like I'm diving deeper into this ocean. Like this endless, endless ocean. And the further back I go, it's like I'm just diving deeper and deeper and deeper into myself. And what I've kind of come to realize is that it's almost like it's the first step to understanding the kind of cosmic mind in terms of, because if we think about it, like everything is kind of the same energy perceiving through so many different lenses, and the past lives we remember in this life are very indicative of what this life represents. Because in my belief, we have all lived every life. That's my personal belief. But
yeah,
certain archetypes will come up in our past life readings. And you know what? It could be, you know, even if it's completely imaginary, even if you've gone into some hypnagogic hallucination where you've imagined it all, and there's this, you know, this scene of like you riding a chariot in Rome comes up, even if it is imaginative, the imagination is the doorway, firstly, into the unconscious, to dreams, and into symbols. So if this archetype, let's say, of the chariot comes up, you think that's just coming up for some random coincidence? Why is this coming up for you? And this is what happens when you're in, dive into past life, and these questions really start to come up, and you start to become like an archaeologist of yourself. And you're like digging up, why does this archetype mean so much to me? Because, you know, someone could have this dream of like riding dolphins in a past life, or like flying through the sky in the past life, or being some huge king or emperor. Like, right? So everyone could have different imaginations. But the thing is, it's the connection you feel to it. It's not really like, you feel
it's subjective. Something. It's subjective is what you're saying. It's not based on like the scientific, like 100% sure that this happened. Yeah. It's more like how you're connecting to the archetype. Like, for example, me, when I've been told I've had like lots of past lives in royalty, but then also lots of past lives dirt poor, that resonated a lot with me, you know, because like I do have these two sides, you know, I do have this really like I can feel myself in both places. I can feel how I've learned the lessons of great riches and great fame, but I've also learned the lessons of you know, barely having enough food to eat and just living off the land and stuff. And connecting to archetypes is incredibly important, because it gives us some perspective, and it gives us some ideas on how to move forward in our life. And like, it gives us some ideas, and you can look at the astrology and all the, you know, whatever tarot, whatever it is that floats your boat, to give you more clues onto what those themes are. But it's really amazing when you're able to kind of see it through a dream or a meditation or a whatever, you know, something more physical.
Cause also reading. Like, let's say you need courage, right? It's hard to find courage in the archetypes of the modern world, right? We don't, you know, we don't have those stories that are ingrained into us. Like, you know, back when you were sitting around the fires and you had these tales of all these heroes, you know, and that was kind of spoken and passed on. It's like, you don't really have that nowadays. You kind of get lost in the social media and the things, you know, this whole weird world. But when you tap into your past lives and archetypes, you find that there. It's like, if I was lacking courage, I can find that courage in a past version of myself. And it really resonates. And I find that strength that person that I once was had. And it's
like syncs the Viking.
It's like, like I synchronize with it. And it then becomes a part of me.
Yeah, man. Like almost like, just imagining a past version of you, because then you see, and this is dope, like you see that you are this being with limitless potential, that you can be like, because we put each other as humans, we have a tendency to put ourselves in these little boxes of like, oh, I can do this, oh, I can only do this. But when you think about how you've probably been everything in different past lives, you've been, you know, like the triple Aries, you've been like the mystic, you've been this, you've been that, like you've been super strong, you've been you know, like it kind of push away these self-limiting beliefs we might have about ourselves, and realize that like anything is possible. You know, I've done everything in a past life, so I can do anything in this life. Oh, like music, for example, I know I've been a musician in past lives. If I really wanted to like dial in on that, maybe that could be motivation, or that could be kind of an energy I use to kind of get me to get through the hard part of learning how to make music.
Yeah, exactly. If you can, it's like, but yeah, what you remember in this lifetime about your past lives will influence you. And it has a specific meaning, even if it's all made up. Even try it for yourself. Try to go into this hypnotic meditation and visualize that. And visualize yourself as something other than what you are. That is such an important exercise, because what you physically, are,
not like from a heart place, right? Like more of like a...
Yeah, like out of a different body, like, or out of a different mindset. Like, of course, there's the central soul, you know, it's the, you know, the limitless thing that is just pure energy. That is really us, right? The soul.
Yeah.
But yeah, in terms of like a personality thing, it's like, we get so hooked on what our personality is, thinking that is what we are.
So right? Trey, you want to hear a great question that you can answer? What's the difference between personality and soul?
All right. Well, personality is a whole mixture of things. So it's what our parents, you know, told us to be, what the world's told us to be.
Conditioning.
Conditioning. It's it's also, you know, positive things. It's also what our soul wants to express. It's our interests. It's our... ideas, our beliefs, our opinions about ourselves, our opinion about other people. So it's this whole conglomeration of our life, literally this life, that is almost like a split by split by split, like every single moment that has kind of accumulated that into this big collage. And we choose parts of ourselves. Sometimes it's unconscious, but most of the time we kind of have an outer and an inner personality. You know, we have this side that we've made. It's like a creation, like we formed out of clay a personality, and we show to the world who we want to be, right? And there's, of course, this deeper inner personality, which is like, you know, it's closer to the core, closer to the soul, where it's our, like our sparks, our dreams, our aspirations. Like, where does that come from? It comes from these little, you know, little bursts of energy and light. And as we go deeper and deeper, so then we get into the unconscious, and then we go deeper, deeper, deeper. And, you know, that's when we really at the center of it all, like a sun with the personality as like different planets rotating around it, you know, planets that we created, planets that have our own meaning to it. In the center is the soul that gives everything life. And a lot of the time we've lost the connection to the soul, and we've invested fully in the creation of the personality. And we've labeled that as ourselves, our personality as ourselves, but that's not what it is. And the soul is the thing that lives on. This body, this personality will die just like everything. You know, it's a transient, we're in a transient time. Even personality over life will change, but there's something at the core of everyone. And this is the soul that lives on. And it is what I think the yogis call the purusha, which is the individualized sense of self. It's the soul that's immaterial. It hasn't manifested in the material world, and it has an energy frequency, and it's completely unique, completely you. And everyone has this different, and it's supreme. It's all, it's like, it's pure, it's, and it's out of time, out of all of this, and it's connected to everything, and we're all connected to one another. And there, this frequency, it's like pure observation, but it's an energy, and that energy is the gift that everyone's really has to offer. That is, I feel like, the true value of a person is in their soul, and it's an energetic offering.
Yeah, and well said, you know, and I think of like, so then you ask the question like, okay, so if the personality is just something that, I mean, okay, I think that our souls, you know, like in a sense, our souls have personalities, like, you know, I probably have like a similar sense of humor, for example, right? Like in a lot of lifetimes, but like the conditioning, right? That big piece of like, if there is a part of us, a part of how I am and how you are and how everyone is, that's going to go away when we die, it's going to leave. Wouldn't you want to overcome that and be closer to that real, real version of you before that?
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, that's kind of for me, what, when I, with this, all this work, that's a lot of the motivation is just thinking like, it's fucking useless to like these little parts of like ego and kind of what you were describing, like it's useless. And, you know, just like, it's why I think about, yeah, like tuning into the heart chakra, like tuning into compassion and kind of letting go of like for example, like materiality, you know, like I'm not gonna like, and like I do like nice things, but at the same time, I can't take a fucking Ferrari to the grave with me, you know, I can't take it to the afterlife. It's just a creation of another human based on whatever materials they use and whatever motor they created or whatever in marketing. And, you know, things, so that's like why, like looking at energy, looking at everything in life as energy is so much more valuable and gives, you know, experiences, energy, relationships, all that stuff. That's where the real value is.
Yeah. And yeah, I think that the personality is like a pet, actually. I don't think it's useless because we can interact with one another. It's like, it's what makes our experience here our experience. Like, you know, if everyone was just this, you know, if everyone had no ego,
yeah,
we'd have no way to like really have our individual communications with one another. So it's like, but what happens is that we've put too much importance there. And what happens is that we also care about it getting hurt, like about someone, like, you know, we it's this pet that we can like mold and create. And it's like our little play thing, you know, in this lifetime, like, here's my personality. Like, it's just something that's light, that should be light and, you know, nothing that to take seriously. But for some reason, we've taken so much importance into it that it's now become everything. And the ego and the personality have become everything. And it's what rules our world now. And you're so right about energy. Like, if we think about what things do we let into our life, like, okay, I'm gonna buy this Ferrari, but it's like, what energy is that gonna produce for me? Like, what legacy is that gonna leave behind? Like,
yeah,
you know,
and maybe bad, so it's things. Like,
yeah,
maybe the Ferrari will distance you from your family, or from, it'll create a gap between you and the people. You know, maybe it'll make you lonely, right?
Yeah, and maybe you'll have, your ego will develop. Yes, I'm finally cool because I have this Ferrari. You know, it'll have this like, yeah, now people, you know, I've made it, you know, it'll have all this ideas like what the Ferrari actually represents. But this is why I think, you know, I mean, my, you know, people can, there's a certain amount of like in this world where money will get you a food, shelter, and a home. And that is, you know, if you, unless you're a yogi or some mystic that doesn't need any of that, you know, because what they've done is they've invested everything into their soul, everything into God. And what's that, what that has done is all the things that we take as necessity that we need, like food and water and, you know, that they've, they're like, I can do, you know, I don't need that much. You know, I can just walk the earth with a blanket. And, you know, that's one extreme, and that's their karma. For me personally, I want to do things in this world.
you know, I feel like I've done that too many times. I feel like I've walked barefoot through the forest, the jungles, starving, you know, feeding on energy instead of food. Like this time, it's like, I'm excited for this world, you know, I'm excited for this time and where the potential of humans we can go. And I just, like, I'm excited to create and to just, cause that's why we're here. That's why we're in this density, is to,
to
carry those out. Because if we were just meant to be in the spiritual world, what was the point of being here, you know?
Yeah, especially for me and you, like, we both kind of received information from different forces or different sources that we're not typically individuals who reincarnate on Earth, you know? I think I can say that without a sense of ego, that it's probably pretty obvious. I mean, like, not that many men are doing what we're doing. You know, Chanel from our group messaged me about that yesterday, and it kind of like was a nice spark of like, kind of like, oh yeah, I am doing some things good, you know? Cause like she said something that was very sweet. I didn't reply yet, but it was like, she was like, you are, you know, there's not that many guys like you, Trey and Dave. Let me read actually what she said. Hold up. Cause it's kind of, she said, blah, 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 blah. Also, I think with your gifts, you can be healing to other men. So just, this is like me, but also you and other guys who are kind of in touch spiritually, because a lot of males are blocked in their spirituality and dismiss astrology and esoteric topics. But if another man can explain it to them, they might be more open to it. There are very few men like you, Trey and Dave out there. Yeah. So like the whole idea, it made me kind of think about the whole idea, of being a pioneer, especially for us as men, you know, like we almost have to kind of beat to the beat of our own drum. Cause there really aren't that many role models for people like me and you, for Western males who are following a route primarily that's, you know, more dominated by women, right? Like spirituality, and seen by a lot of men as being kind of like BS. So it's tough, right?
Yeah. But that's karma. The thing is, the conditioning for men is extreme in this point, because it is a man's world, you could say, like a man's ego created from greed, conditioning more men to join that. And I can see why females are breaking away from that, because it doesn't include them, you know? They've had to fight hard to actually be seen as equal. And so I can see why they're rejecting the ideas of this world. Whereas men in their ego are like, this is mine, you know, this is my world, you know, I am powerful here. So it's harder for men to make that decision. And because it suits them, you know, they're under the illusion of power, and they're under the illusion of this, it's like this addiction to this feeling of them being in strength, but it's this weird sense of the word power. It's like it is another vampiric sense of the word power, where other people have to suffer for you to, you know, I guess, you know, gain that. So it is, but men are slowly waking up. Definitely women are going much faster. And
it can be tough sometimes, but for me, it goes back to what we were saying before, is that I let go of that ego part of me. You know, I think of like the divine, and I think of myself like as energy, and I think of myself as like navigating through this world, maybe a little bit ahead of my time in a sense. And I zoom out from this 2000, this is back to our past life thing. I zoom out from like 2021 into like a timeless place, or like just from like way zoomed out. And I see that it doesn't fucking matter. There's no point. Like, I just need to be me. And if I'm not being me, that's the only way where I can feel like a disappointment. If I'm me, even if things don't go as perfect as I want them to be, like, it's still good. It's still good. Yeah, I'll never sell out. Fuck that shit.
This is how I see it. It's like your soul has a signature it wants to write on the score of time, right?
Yeah.
So you incarnate into the physical realm and your soul has this expression it wants to put down forever that will always be remembered until this universe, until time collapses and doesn't and ceases to exist, right? And yeah. There's this huge composition going on. But what's happening is souls are being herded. Souls are being herded away from their natural expression and they're being herded into, you know, it's just like they're putting the blinders on horses, or you know, you got the big wolf like directing all the sheep into one skyscraper building to earn money for the one person at the top. Yeah. It's exactly, so what's happening is that the world is redirecting these souls and their expression isn't getting fulfilled. And that's why so many people go through midlife crisis or career changes or huge big events that will like shake everything up for them. And you know, turn the world upside down because it's like the universe, it's like shaking you, like, hey, wake up. And like you're in a dream, and people some people will go through their whole life and only at the end will they realize that, like, they, when they look back on their life, like, oh God, I didn't do what I was meant to be doing. I didn't do it. And so many rich people and people at the top end up going, you know, are hugely depressed. You know, just because you have money doesn't mean you're happy.
Yeah, man. It's like the book, the Death of Ivan Ilyich. Have you read that or heard about it?
No.
I haven't read it, but basically it's a book that's exactly that. I think it's a Russian book, obviously. And he essentially, it's like an old man who just like lived his life, like doing nothing. And it's like the last few days of him being alive at the hospital, I'm pretty sure, just talking. And it's like a real book, like just talking about everything he regrets and just like all of his reflections from this, some deep stuff. I really want to read that book. I have it right over there. I just never fucking do it. That'd be a powerful one. Yeah. But anyways.
I mean, at the end of it all, it's like, okay, there's past life, multiple lives. So what is the point of it all? It's like, for me, the reason I talk about these things, the reason I do these things is because I just have this undesirable, like, I don't know where it's coming from, but this impulse, this desire for us as humans to evolve.
Yeah.
It feels like we thought we've stopped evolving, right? It's like we were monkeys and then we became humans and now we're at the peak of our, you know, existence.
Like, capitalism, oh, everything's perfect. Yeah. No need to change anything.
Exactly. It's like, wait, what? It's like everyone's forgotten that there's we've stopped our climb consciously, and I just want to, because I know I have been to that place. I remember understand the evolution of humanity in its most natural harmonic occurrence, and I just want to be part of that evolution, and I want us to all move that way. I don't want us, because I care about humanity for, I don't know what, you know, is this for life. I care for life and
for what is.
I don't want to see us go extinct. I don't want to see us have to scramble for a planet and, you know, have to merge with machines or go down some weird twisted thing. So this is why I speak. And this is why I kind of moved to this, because spirituality is an evolution. It's the evolution of the conscious mind upwards into a greater understanding of the universe and of ourselves.
Beautifully said. Well, shit. I mean, should we end it on that high note or anything else that you want to say? We're about a little bit over an hour.
Yeah, I think we covered what we were covering.
Yeah, I've been timestamping everything. I was like thinking, it was like, maybe it'd be cool to have it be like just around an hour. Not that we needed to like stick to any restraints, but yeah, besides that, what's been up? Been good. I've been fucking really like up with my finances, like Saturn's on my Venus. And I've just been like, for the first time in my life, like keeping track of all my spending on my phone and doing like an Excel worksheet. It's just so funny how the astrology Saturn is all about structure and like making graphs and stuff. And it's on my Venus Venus is spending. And it's just like, it's just funny how that works out.
Yeah, I don't know what transits I have, but around the Aries new moon, I had this like disconnect from fiber. Like, I'm like, this is not, doesn't feel right anymore.
You're done with fiber?
I'm not 100% done, but what I've done is I've stopped accepting all the orders that come through, because normally I'll just accept as many orders, you know. So what I've just doing is I'm finishing off the big projects that I've got. But what I've done is I've reoriented all my direction towards actually actualizing this book, like full book, for this fantasy fiction book. And I've already made a plan, a 6-month timeline. So
you released the audio one on, I think it's on your Instagram, right?
That was a side project that I just did to kind of get myself, but that actually, I don't think I'm going to continue with that one, because this was just like a random thing I did, but it was like, it catalyzed the importance, because I realized I didn't have enough time to write that YouTube one, because I was like, I didn't feel great about that story, because I was like, I didn't have enough time, because I've been so focused on Fiverr. And I'm like, oh shit, I'm doing all this work for other people. I'm writing other people's stories. I'm not writing.
Yo, you know what's crazy? How that relates to your astrology with your south node and north node. South node being, you know, the part in your chart that relates to like the been there, done that in past lives. Your south node's in the sixth house in fucking Aries. Regardless, it's in the house of serving others.
Sixth house is Aries for me. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's like being an entrepreneur, like it's like being a warrior, but also serving others. That's like your tendency. So in this life, 12th house Libra, it's conjunct your Mercury. It's like for you, Mercury, your voice, to put your own voice into a, and really dive into like the collective unconscious and humanity as a whole and spirituality, the occult, esoteric, the vastness of all that's possible. 12th house is, I can speak about it for 40 minutes and use eloquent Libra terminology and words that are sociable and understandable by the masses, not just some like weird, like crazy, like spiritual person that hasn't showered in 20 years with dreads and stuff, like an actually like eloquent kind of Libra energy expressed like in a way that people can understand that has that brings balance to humanity.
Yeah, because I mean, I'm writing fantasy fiction, but what I'm doing is like the magic, everything is real. It comes from real concepts, like real. So it's going to be through fantasy fiction books, but everything I'm talking about is really spiritual stuff. So yeah. And it's crazy because around that time too, I had that dream, which really helped me transition to this past. No, it wasn't a dream. It was a past life regression. And I was this shoemaker in this small Irish village. And it was always raining, and my father was like, after my mother died, my father was like really mean, and he ended up drinking himself to death. But I took over his business, which was making shoes. Yeah. And I barely had enough money to put food on the table. I ate alone every night with one candle, just eating the soup, the same old soup. And I was making these shoes, and you know, my body was starting to ache. I was like doing all this work, making all the shoe for other people, and then I was hardly making enough money. And then one day I just decided to stop, and I took off my shoes. And I just walked out into the Irish countryside. And what I realized was that I never needed to be doing all that work to provide for myself, because everywhere I went, even though I would be hungry, like maybe I wouldn't eat for 2 days, but then I would arrive in a village and there'd be a nice person who would like take me in, or I would trade work to get some food. But it gave me this freedom that all of a sudden I'm no longer shackled to this same old thing over and over again. And I could do what, and then my heart finally did what it wanted to do. And then the end of this regression was like me just standing over the cliffs, like cliffs of Dover or whatever, just like looking out far into the horizon, just like at the end of my life. And like, you know, so when I had that dream, it was like, it also helped me to transition like away, because you know, the fiver was constant money, but it's like, it what my heart was starting to sink, you know?
Yeah, man. You felt good into it. And that's, why past lives can be so valuable, because it showed, like, you were able to zoom out and see what's really important. And like you were saying before, so many people live their whole fucking lives, and then they have these, like, don't have the realizations that you want to have now when you're in, you know, a wheelchair or in a hostel bed. Have it now. And past lives can help you get to that point. So dreams can be so, like, such valuable tools to kind of get in touch with your unconscious and get some messages, you know, like, even the dream I had lately was, like, really based on, like, success and just, like, continuing to follow through, something so small, but it was like follow through with your, like, driving, like, really, like, it's important, like, for you to, like, that's what I came away with, like, to get my driver's license, because it's going to open up all that Sagittarius moon exploration around Romania. Like, I have so much to see in this country, and I've seen so little.
And then your vlogs can really start jumping up, because, like, once you get a car and you have that freedom, you can get that travel vlogs going.
Exactly. So, like, that's like just a really mini example that kind of was like, that's important. So, what I wrote the quote, and I've been writing, like, timestamps this whole time. That's why I've been looking down. People, we're having timestamps for y'all. I wrote, the universe providing for you when you're on your heart's path. And that's just so, like, you know, I saw that so much. And that actually, this goes back to, like, we say we're done, but then we keep talking. like, this goes back to me when I was first wanting to move to Romania. And also, like, with prayer. Like, for me, with prayer, when I pray for something, I always tell God or spirit or whatever, like, the reason I want this thing is, and I always explain to, like, how it's beneficial, not on, like, a material level, but on, like, an emotional heart level. You know, I remember once I magically fixed my broken laptop that was completely broken, like a MacBook, because I got so deep in meditation. It was like everything. I looked on all the forums. Like, it was like, everyone's like, it's toast, you know, bring it in, but it's fucked. Like, the whole thing is like exploded, or not exploded, but just broken. I don't know the terms, but, like, I got so deep into meditation. I was in my heart chakra completely. I was like, please, like, I have such valuable information on this computer, like, so much stuff that's, like, you know, contributing to my writing career, to my astrology, like, all my client stuff. And I'm doing this to, like, help, you know, help people out on their journeys in life. And just, like, weigh all my journal entries I've written, like, all these deep fucking things. And the next day I just was like, okay, I guess I should try it. Kind of like today, how my account came back, by the way, guys, Jesse and Astro is back. And I just turned on the fucking computer and it just turned on, dude. I was like, what?
Wow.
Crazy.
Yeah. Crazy. Yeah. You sometimes get little miracles thrown at you like that, you know, especially when it's really in line with the heart of things. Yeah, and when you get that and you nail it and it's really in line, you know, they always say the universe provides for that.
And with my Instagram, really quickly, last night I did what I haven't really done. I literally just made a video, because I'm all about honesty, and I'm not, like, depressed or anything, but, like, I was feeling depressed last night and I made a video just, like, called, like, this is my current mental health state. And I literally talked about some of the issues I've been having, and my whole point with it was, like, I'm going to be an open book. Like, even if I'm, like, famous one day, or if I'm, like, in a big position, I'm always going to be someone who's, like, and I'm not saying I'm going to be, I'm just saying, even if I was, I would always want to be an open book. And it's interesting to me how me admitting that led to my account coming back the next day. It was all, cause I always felt like there was something that needed to happen. Yeah. Like really getting real. Like, I wasn't crying or anything. I was just like, like, I was very honest with, like, what's going on with me. And man, crazy shit.
And before we go, I know, just, we say this, but just, like, really reach out, because we're going to be taking all your like,
oh shit,
you want,
we have a call. Thanks for reminding me. We have that question. So yeah, guys, just like, so thanks, Trey, for reminding me. So please, give us any questions you have on anything we're talking about or anything in general. DM me, you know, at Jesse and Astro, or Trey at Trahan O'Grady, and we will answer your question as long as it's appropriate, but even if it's inappropriate. I love that Lisa someone who has a great podcast. I was on her podcast. She sent me this, and she just sent me another message. Oh my God. Oh, I meant you two as guests on the podcast. So she did it on accident, but it actually made it so it's perfect. So it's like, yeah, we will answer any questions at the end of the episode. So what she accidentally asked, let's see. So she wanted to know about readings during all. So, okay, are you and or your co-host, okay, talking about readings during altered states, basically getting / giving reads when drunk, tipsy, high, and also maybe the types of psychic intuitive energies or insights that can come or be received when in altered states naturally that listeners might recognize and see more as possibly an energy working real experience. What do you think, Trey?
Wait, I think she was wanting us to go on and talk
about that. She was. I read it wrong, but like, yeah. I still see it as a synchronicity.
What I think is like, because now that we're doing these special segments at the beginning of the episodes where we just, you know, today we did the reading of the, you know, the soulmate drawing. We would love to have suggestions of like what you guys would want us to see from us. Like, what do you want to see? Do you want to see us speak to some, you know, past life reader? Do you want us to go to some Mayan astrologer and get a reading? Like, what is it you want to see from us? We'd be happy to just explore those ideas.
Yeah, but let's also answer this question, like, because let's also like, I want us to have a segment at the end of each episode where it's like answering your questions, because I think that's what people listening to that will have questions and they'll want to ask them, you know. So the answer, so my view on this question, so basically what Lisa, I think if you're listening, what you're asking, and she did want us to be on the show, but you know, we can go on her show too and discuss that there. And we talked about this recently, Trey. So weed, you know, for me doesn't work. My opinion, and I don't want to judge, so I want to be careful. Like, I just have, I've talked about like my relationship. Sorry,
are we talking about substances in general as altered states?
Let me reread it. So,
read it and then get your understanding of it.
So she's asking about doing readings like, you know, psychic readings or intuitive readings during altered states. I think she means psychic readings, but just readings in general. Basically getting / giving reads when drunk, tipsy, high, and also maybe the types of psychic / intuitive energies or insights that can come when in these states.
Okay. I feel that. I understand it now.
Yeah.
I definitely feel on marijuana and LSD and mushrooms and DMT and ketamine that those have produced some profound psychic and out of like crazy cosmic things for me. I really do believe it. Like on ketamine, I was seeing like the future before it happened. On DMT, I experienced past lives. Like on LSD, I got to connect with the entire universe and everything at once, like infinite consciousness. Like I do think that these drugs or these substances do connect you to higher things. But then of course there's the abuse of them, which is very different.
Yes. And that can cloud your third eye and stuff. Like if you're like smoking weed all the time, I think it can actually, like you were telling me before, like when you were smoking, how you would get all these intense intuitions, but then what would happen? It would kind of cloud you overall, right?
Yeah, so in the beginning, especially when I had a fresh mind and I smoked weed lightly in the beginning, the amount of colors, visual, sensory perception, like I heard buzzing, like frequencies everywhere. Like I would see things every time I closed my eyes. I would like, you know, I had it was increasing my sense perception. And then the more I smoke it, it's like, it becomes cloudier and cloudier and thicker and thicker. And it's because when you get out of balance with these things, then, and your tolerance increases and all that, you can't get that clarity. It's like, it's something that really has to be done ceremonial and, you know, or like sometimes I would use LSD or mushrooms to, like, after I hadn't used it in months and months and months and I was kind of unclear about where I wanted to go.
Yeah,
I would take that and it would give me exactly the answers I needed because it was connecting me to a deeper sense of self. And I'd only take it once, right? I take it once for clarity and a great, like, it's like the remembrance. It's like, oh yeah, that's what's real. And then
it gives you new perspective.
Yeah.
It like it recalibrates. So yeah, like I think we both have a similar opinion that like taking mushrooms, even my favorite MDMA, sometimes, occasionally, mushrooms has also had such amazing impact on my life. The few times I've done it, hasn't been a while, but like it can recalibrate you, and it can, and like maybe just that one night for like MDMA, that one night of incredible happiness for me. Like I've gotten out of deep depressions from MDMA. Because it just like got me in touch with like that really light, happy child side of me. And you know, you can never put like too much value on, or enough value on, like what one night of laughter and fun and it can do. But my opinion is like okay, there's yogis, there's levels to this shit. Like there's people who can get past whatever. Like if I'm being really honest, not weed, but I do think that, like I've done maybe one reading drunk before, and I did a good job. So I don't think, for me personally, I prefer sober, and I think that's what I owe my clients, because I think that's where the true gift comes, the true intuition. Yeah. But I don't think that, like, if, for example, like if I'm really nervous or anxious sober, and having a drink would like calm me down, then that would be the drunk version would be better, honestly. So the best for me is like sober, high vibe, good energy, workout, you know, meditate, all that stuff. But yeah, I'm just not with the weed. That's just me personally. I have nothing against people, and maybe some readers can you know, have it differently. We all have different reactions is my kind of thing, but I wouldn't want to get a reading from someone smoking weed during the reading, or even in general, probably.
Yeah, I would, like in terms of readings, I would get someone, I would want a person who can put themselves into a fucking psychic trance without needing a substance, you know?
Yeah.
Like that's, for me, that is an evolved being. They're not, they don't need the aid of another plant or something to get them there. Even though when I'm on mushrooms, I can like really, I could probably give an amazing psychic reading, but it's like, I don't know if I trust someone who's always going to be on substances to be giving these readings, because, you know, I want someone who can get there naturally.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so it's different for everyone, I guess, is the answer. But, you know, preferring, I think this is some sacred work, you know, that we're doing. And just figuring out, like what works for you. Like every drug is different. Every substance is different. Every human is different. So it's more of a personal thing. You know, maybe there is a substance that works well with you in readings that you feel like doesn't cut your intuition. But it's really different for everyone. And you have to kind of honestly ask yourself the question. That's kind of my two cents.
Yeah. I mean, I can see like shamans who would use.
Yeah.
Like those yogis stuff, but for like big ceremonies, but they're trained, you know, they have a lineage where you go through some intense shit to become a shaman. You're not just some person who's grown up in a, you know, suburban neighborhood and then decides to start taking mushrooms to give psychic readings, right? It's very different. And so it's like, if you're part of a lineage, like an ayahuasca lineage, where you know, you give the ceremony and you're like this shamanic healer for everyone, that is, I think, a very different thing. You know, yeah, that is very different. But if you're like a Western psychic with no lineage and you're just kind of like high while you're giving the readings.
Yeah. But let's not, you know, let's say this all and also just know that we're not judging. If you are listening and you are someone that smokes weed, and gives readings and it works for you, everyone's fucking different. This is more like me and Trey, our opinions, and kind of like how we would feel comfortable, like who we would feel comfortable getting reading from. But then again, there's also fucking yogis in India who smoke hash all the time. Maybe that isn't great, as you said one time, but mm-hmm. they're still able to give a fucking good reading. So
yeah, weed for me is a bit different, just because like if I trust the person and they're smoking weed, I won't really care. Like, actually, I don't really care if I think they're a good person and they're they feel authentic and they feel genuine, then, you know, it doesn't, then use the plant to get this heightened state like that. That would be kind of cool, actually, you know?
Yeah, if it works for them. Dope.
Yeah, but I don't, it's like, yeah, but I guess I was thinking about like the mainstream and, you know, people who kind of can't get there sober, but then use these plants.
Yeah, that's true too. I think from that standpoint, from that standpoint, I would not advise it. And I would say that it's probably going to get in the way of your real third eye development and intuition and just brain in general.
I mean, every time I did LSD, it was like the amount of consciousness you have right now, the openness, because, you know, LSD connects all those pathways in your brain. You can get here sober, and everything, it always, at the end of a trip, the message was you can get here sober. And so that's why I stopped doing those, because I got what I needed from them. I came to a resolution and a conclusion. And now, you know, I'm having it where, you know, I'm getting close to states where I can come into really heightened states. Of course, nowhere near like a yogi or a shaman or something like that, because I don't practice enough. I'm not that disciplined. Like, I'm still in this world, you know. I do my practice, but it's a little one, and that little one gives me some amazing fruits. But
yeah, man.
Yeah, you know, I could go way deeper with it, but you know, I am where I am, and but sober is the key, and it's the key to evolution. If you're doing yoga and smoking, and you're doing yoga and doing drugs, it'll hinder your evolution, I think. As long as you're not using it consciously.
And it's different for everyone also. Because even like Agnia was talking about in our Cosmos community about human design. And I have a certain human design where like things like the vaccine or substances in general, they don't really affect me that much. But
the question is here, like the real question is, why are you taking the substance, right?
Yeah.
Because you can do everything that substance can do. So why are you taking it? That's like the real question. Are you taking it because...
To feel more elevated, like, I'm just guessing with the weed, to feel like more vocal, whatever. There's a million, like more like...
Yeah, so, but now you're taking power away from yourself, because the actual development is like, oh, you need this to make yourself feel this?
Yeah, that's exactly. I agree.
So it's like, yeah, so... I feel like substances fall away because you think this is giving you this high, this temporary high, you think is benefiting you, you think is this, but it actually has like what is, but it's taking away, because you could be spending that time actually working to get there, because it's the work you do sober will get you to the point eventually. It's longer, but you're getting a quick fix through the drugs, right? You get that quick high, that quick intuition, but developing that naturally and sober is so much more rewarding, because it stays. You don't lose it afterwards.
Exactly. Well, that's a very good place for us to stop. So before completing this episode, so guys, we would both really appreciate, you know, any subscriptions. If you guys are listening on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google, Pandora, whatever, we're everywhere. You know, subscribing is really good for us. Also, you know, downloading the episodes. Yeah, it's free. Downloading the episodes really helps. I don't know if there's like a watch or download. And also, if anyone really wants to support, rate, review us. Give us, if you want, you know, if you like us, because by reviewing us, that's actually going to like move us up some kind of like algorithm or whatever. We want to get a larger audience, not for selfish reasons, you know, just like anyone that starts a podcast would want to have more people listening to it and get their messages out and maybe be able to attract, more interesting guests for you guys. So reviews would be highly appreciated. Yeah. And yeah, also just feel free to DM us any questions you might have. Like we said, we will answer them if they're appropriate, as you just saw us do that now. It can be about anything, something we talked about in this episode, a different episode, or just anything in general. So thanks so much, guys. And until next time.